1872, isn't it, has brought out this legislation. Usse pehle India mein, you all know that we had a prior to the British came into picture, we used to have a Hindu law of evidence, then a Mohammedan law of evidence. You know that that is the brief history. If you go through any of the commentaries, you will find it here. Now, since there were not substantive proceedings in that, the James Stephen thought it fit to bring the legislation in conformity with the English law of evidence. That is the eminent author Taylor, who wrote the Evidence Act for England based on the common law. So more or less, this is the adaptation of the English law of evidence of Taylor's evidence with suitable amendment to the Indian condition. That is why the Privy Council and the Superior Courts have held that year, wherever there is ambiguity in the Act, interpretation is concerned, we had to take the help of English case laws. So that is how we still, the English judgments of the Privy Council and King's Court and Queen's Bench, they are all relevant and taken into consideration, they hold it here for the purpose of interpretation. So we do not completely give a go-by to the English authorities. Now let us see. Now as a student, you have to understand what is the significance of the Indian Evidence Act. Now the Indian Evidence Act, for all you all should know, is a branch of adjective law. Okay? An adjective law is a procedural law which tells you as to how to enforce the substantive law. So you learned while discussing the Code of Civil Procedure and CRPC last time that the laws are basically broadly divided into two categories, the substantive law and the procedural laws. The examples of substantive law we gave you in civil cases, Transfer of Property Act, Succession Act, RERA Act, Specific Relief Act, where right title interest is derived. In criminal cases, it is the Indian Penal Code, all other criminal legislation which deal with the offenses and the punishment, they are all the substantive law in the country. And the procedural laws for civil matters is the Code of Procedure, civil procedure, which tells you as to which forum you are required to go to, as to which court of law you are required to go to, what is the jurisdiction of the court and where the document print should be filed. That is the role of the CPC, a procedural law. The CPC entirely doesn't tell you, nor the CRPC does entirely tell you how the a case which has been filed in a court of law for attaining substantial rights can be proved. How does the party substantiate the allegation? What is the mode of achieving this? Because you understood that here, mere presentation of a plain is not evidence. And the written statement is not evidence. Affidavits are not evidence. Similarly, a first information report is not a substantive bit of evidence. A statement recorded by a police officer under Section 161 CRPC, nor under 164, are completely evidence. And in fact, the police officer cannot record confession, statement made. So they are all on evidence. Now, when that is not evidence, what is evidence? So the Evidence Act will tell you what is the nature of evidence you require, what documents are evidence, what statements are evident, what circumstances can be evidence, what other material can be evidence. So there are various types of evidence. For example, there is a direct evidence. There is a hearsay evidence, which is normally a weak evidence, which is not admissible except barring under certain cases under Section 32, dying declaration and other cases. We'll come to know about it. Then there are primary evidence. There is secondary evidence relating to document. There is evidence called extrinsic evidence. That is, when you have a written document, you are not permitted to lead oral evidence except in certain cases. then you also understand, you learned in the IPC and CRPC, there is a exculpatory evidence and inculpatory evidence, isn't it? We'll explain this everything, of course, you know about this here. There is a presumptive evidence. I mean, the court may presume, the court shall presume what is a conclusive evidence. So these are all aspects are dealt under the Indian Evidence Act, which is a very comprehensive and beautiful act, in nutshell put in 167 section by Sir John Stephen. So as earlier I told you that here, the common law in USA, in almost all the states, there's a statutory law of evidence, except in the state of Louisiana, which does not follow the system here of common law. They have the they won statutory laws. In India, we have a common law, we have a mixed dual law, that is both statutory law as a common law. The law of tort, it doesn't have a statutory law. We follow the English common law, isn't it? And Mohammedan law is again is not a statute law. It is a law based on unwritten, it is precedents and guidelines given in the Quran. And similarly, there are various legislation and the principles of injunction based on doctrine of justice, equity, and good conscience. They are all based on the English common law, unwritten practice, the judicial precedent, customs and usages laid down by the superior courts and laid down here. So that is exactly the role. Now, again, our Indian Evidence Act is not applicable to all forums. You know, it is it is only applicable to civil courts in India. You know, civil courts mean a court which is a judicial officer who is capable of recording evidence on oath. So you will be knowing here, when you go to consumer court, they record evidence. When you go to a motor accident tribunal, the evidence are recorded. A family court evidence is recorded. Family court evidence is recorded. And arbitrators are also recording evidence. You know that here. And industrial tribunal records evidence. But the Indian Evidence Act is strictly not applicable to this forum, which I will tell you why. Because they're all quasi-judicial authorities. It doesn't mean that they cannot record evidence. They can record evidence, but they will have to follow the principles of justice, equity, and good conscience. But whereas the civil courts, like for example, in the city of Bombay, you have the High Court of Judicature at Bombay, which is a district court. In the city of Bombay, the High Court exercising jurisdiction under the provisions of jurisdiction under the OOCJ is a district court. Isn't it? Many people may not be taken by surprise, because it has. Then we have a city civil court. We have a court of small causes court in the city of Bombay. So they are all city judicial officers sitting. They can record evidence. We have a judicial magistrate first class in various districts. In the city of Bombay, you have a metropolitan magistrates, isn't it? So they are judicial officers. The CPC, the CRPC describes the criminal courts as the court of sessions, the judicial magistrate first class, second class, and metropolitan magistrate and executive magistrate. An executive magistrate is not a judicial magistrate, and he cannot record evidence. I mean, the principles laid down in the Evidence Act are not applicable before the executive officer, before whom you cannot you need not even take a oath. Similarly, under the CRPC, you know that here, a statement recorded by the judge of the accused person under section 313, those are not evidence. That man may go in the box, may say that, yes, my lord, I am describing the nature of the offense and what happened. Yes, I have committed the offense. That is not evidence. Section 313, you learned it here, I won't get into it. Similarly, there are various under the Code of Civil Procedure, all affidavits are not evidence under Order 19. barring the affidavit filed under Order 18, Rule 4, Examination Chief, in pursuance of Section 137 of the Evidence Act, is in evidence. The Act is specifically saying. So the Evidence Act is a strict act where the procedure to be followed is very strict. You will not, if you are having a particular document, the original must come on record first. That is called primary evidence. If you are not able to prove a original document, you have a right to produce a secondary evidence following certain guidelines. And provided if there's a witness who is a direct evidence, his evidence need to be substantiated by other recording as an example. So that is all the Evidence Act tells you. It's an act which does not allow parties to. In the examination chief, you are not permitted to lead your leading question. And your pleadings, whatever you have mentioned in your pleadings, in your plain and written statement, you cannot travel beyond. That is what the Evidence Act says that. But in the cross-examination, extend your limits. That is why. Now let us understand, the Evidence Act is a branch of adjective law, namely also a procedural law, which tells the parties as to how to implement the substantive law. Namely, what kind of a proof you are required to bring, what evidence must become before the court of law, who should be able to depose, who are the competent witnesses, what is the nature of relief sought, and what document, how, when documents can be impounded, when documents can be rejected, when relevant evidence can be taken on record. Admissibility of a document is one thing. See, relevancy of evidence, document or evidence is one thing, and admissibility is different thing, and proof is different thing. You may have produced the grandfather's will before the court of law. This is my grandfather's will. I want a probate, because your probate, your will of a grandfather does not come into effect unless the death takes place. And your will is a zero value unless you obtain a probate under Section 213 of the Indian Succession Act. You have to go before a district court in the city of Bombay High Court. A mere protection of the will, this is my grandfather, not sufficient. But you are required to examine the witness. One of the main executant must be examined. He must be able to say that, yes, this is the will executed by late Mr. So-and-so, the grandfather of the petitioner. He had called me and another witness who has signed. In our presence, all three of us signed together. This is my signature. This is the signature down below is my friend's other signature, and the grandfather, the person who made the testator, has signed this. Because I know the signature because it was done in my presence. Agar woh bolega, I do not know when he has signed it. The will came to my place. His servant brought and signed it. The document is not admissible. So that's Evidence Act tells you when the evidence must be adduced, how it is to be adduced, and what evidence must be laid down. Otherwise, your evidence will be discarded. What is appearing in newspaper these days, you cannot tell the civil court, you take on record the Times of India advertisement, this has given statement. That is not evidence. Somebody has made a defamatory allegation against you in the newspaper, that is not evidence. You need to examine the editor. You need to examine the reporter. He is supposed to give you what is the source of your knowledge, information, and depose it before the court of law. He must come and depose. He must come and testify. He must take an oath under the Indian Oaths Act. When he takes oath, yes, I myself personally seen. I have seen this happen. The defendant was indulging in a campaign of vilification and giving disparaging comments against Mr. A, insulted me, so-and-so. That is called a direct evidence. that comes under the provisions of Section 59 and 60 of the Evidence Act. That's a direct evidence. And if a direct evidence is not available, the court may say that presume certain circumstances indicate that save and except the accused, nobody else has committed. For example, an elderly man, maybe around 70, 80 years, 90 years, staying alone, his servant comes and goes, and nobody has the key except him and the servant. One fine day, he was found dead. And there is no evidence, there is no, nobody has seen it. So the circumstances will say that here, nobody else has come here except the servant. And nobody else could have committed the offense except him. And the offense is proved beyond reasonable doubt from these circumstances which are conclusive. Witnesses may lie, circumstances will not lie. So the chain must be established. The court may draw inferences in such a case. So it's a tough job. If you want to be a good trial lawyer, you must be well versed with the provisions of the Section 1267 of the Evidence Act and solidly know the provisions of CRPC and Evidence Act, which go hand in hand together. So they are the chariots of the same wheel, three wheels of a trial lawyer who want to practice and succeed in the court of law, and you must know the basic principles of Evidence Act thoroughly well. Okay, please note that here, this is a branch of adjective law, or you may also call it a procedural law, which tells you the procedure as to how to set into motion the substantive law and attain justice to the parties. Okay, that is one thing. Now, if you have taken the Bayer Act, I will just explain to you briefly. The Act, you know, just open up your Bayer Act if you have got. The Act has three parts. Just please open it here. It's a very simple Act here. If you can kindly open the Bayer Act here, I will tell you. It has just three parts. Part 1, Part 2, Part 3, which can there 11 chapters. Okay? Yeah, 11 chapters. In Part 1, if you see that here, Part 1, Part 2, Part 3. Part 1 is a relevancy of facts. Okay? Part 2 is a proof of the fact. That is, relevancy of mean what facts are relevant. What evidence you can come before the court of law. Then number 2, dealing with the proof. Part 2 is dealing with the proof of the, what is the proof required before the court of law. Okay? Then Part 3, production of the evidence. Effect of the evidence. Now, only this two. Now, iske andar, you will find out there are total 11 chapters. Now, Part 1 has two chapters that kindly see that here. That is called a preliminary. Preliminary that is starting from Section 1 to 4. 1 to 4, that is a section will tell you the interpretation clauses, the definition of the meaning of the court, the definition of the evidence. It gives the definition of proved, disproved, not proved. What digital signatures, electronic signature, may presume, shall presume, and conclusive proof. I will connect this with each of the sections later on in the ensuing lecture. Now, the chapter 2 deals with the section 5 se lekar, aap dekhenge, 55, relevancy of fact. So, what facts are relevant? So, having learned here in Section 1 to 5, Section 1 will tell you the Act is very applicable. I will take it up immediately after this. Applicability of the Act. Then, interpretation clause, definition clauses. It defines what is a court. This is the only Act in India which gives a definition of the court apart from the General Clauses Act. The CPC, CRPC do not define the court. Courts are too many courts. Consumer court is a court, but it is not a court. It's a tribunal. It's a quasi-judicial authority, isn't it? Then Nobolige Motor Accident Court, that is not a court. And family court, these are all special courts. Family court doesn't record evidence. Evidence Act is strictly not applicable. So we will come to it here. Then, yahan pe likha gaya aapko, then after the definition 1 to 4, then 5 to 55 deal with the relevancy of fact. When you have filed a suit for declaration of your title or for recovery of your property, what facts are relevant before the court? What documents are necessary before the court? You cannot produce irrelevant documents. If it's a suit for declaration that your adopted son of Mr. XYZ, and you cannot bring evidence which is connected to partnership dispute of the family, you cannot bring evidence with regard to company shareholding, you should bring on before the court of law who was your father, who adopted you, where were you born. Thus, if it is disputed fact, please note that evidence can only be brought before the court of law of facts which are disputed. Undisputed facts, you don't require evidence. There's a special section 5758 of the Evidence Act, which tells you admitted facts need not be proved. It is only contentious facts, the disputed facts you are required to prove before the court of law. So section 5 to 55 opens a window for you only with regard to the facts at issue and relevant fact. Now, facts and issue to aapne seekha hai under order 14 CPC. When the pleadings are completed, the judge frames the issues under order 14. From all the material facts, from the pleading, from the letters, correspondence, from the interrogatories. Isn't it? You learned it. Interrogatories are under the provisions of order 11. Isn't it? The plain order 7, the written statement order 8. Then the documents under order 11, 12, 13. Affidavits under order 19. These are the sections which you are required to know, under which here you are permitted to bring your evidence, and the court having regard to all this material frames issues under order 14, rule 1 and 2 and C. The court can frame issues, the facts in issue, material facts and issue of law. You may take up the plea, the court has no jurisdiction. Does the defendant prove that the court has no jurisdiction? Does the plaintiff prove that the suit is not barred by limitation? Does the suit prove that the suit is maintainable for not maintainable for want of statutory notice? So these are the issues. It says that here, section 5, you are allowed to lead evidence with regard to the facts in issue. Now, in the facts in issue before the criminal courts, kya rahega aapko? Framing of a charges under section 2, 11, 12, 13, se lekar 15, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Those are 211 onwards to 20. You are seeing framing of a charge. Charges are framed by a magistrate or a court of sessions or a high court exercising original jurisdiction in criminal cases. After perusing the entire charge sheet, a police report under section 173 and all documents which are produced before the court of law, and when the magistrate collects evidence, when the matter is committed to the court of session under section 207 CRPC, isn't it? It is the court of magistrate under section 190 of the CRPC, which is a court of original jurisdiction, isn't it? It is not the high court or session court. Session court, except in the case of filing of a complaint, defamation complaint against the president of India, vice president, or public authority, that can only become a court of original jurisdiction. Otherwise, a court of session directly does not receive the cases. It is the magistrate who transmits the cases under section 209. That you should know that here. So the collection of the evidence takes place before the magistrate. An offense of murder or rape or tribal, these are tribal cases by the court of session. The magistrate has no power. Under the scheme of the CRPC, section 2425 tells you a magistrate of a judicial magistrate in the city of Mumbai, matter magistrate, can only give punishment up to 7 years. He cannot, though he can try offenses up to life imprisonment. The maximum punishment he can give is 7 years. So it is a court of session, whereas a death sentence wara ho gaya, it is a court of session. So he collects the evidence. When the accused is arrested under section 41 CRPC, he is immediately brought before the magistrate under the provisions of section 57 and Article 22 of the Constitution of India within 24 hours. His custody beyond 24 hours is illegal, illegitimate. You know that here. Then the provisions of Section 167(2) remand procedure is pressed into service. The remand is not as an empty formality. It is the police officer is required to place before the magistrate the entire material. The case diary under Section 172, which is normally not shown to the accused or to his counsel, but it should be shown to the court of law as to what step the police officer has taken after receiving the first information report under Section 154 CRPC. The law mandates that here, no sooner under 154 comes into play, he must transmit the FIR copy to the nearest magistrate, isn't it? And commence the investigation from 156 onwards, say, later Section 196. So these are very wide powers given here. The police officer has a right to arrest the accused person. Now, under the scheme of the provisions of Section 41, you know that here, a police officer cannot mechanically arrest anybody. He is required to form his reasoning under 41, 41A, subclause 1. Under 41(2), he should give reason why is he not arresting, and he must issue a notice under 41A. Now, the recently Supreme Court has released one of the stage person who did a comedian on the ground that his grounds were not furnished under Section 41. The police officer not done his job properly. And if he doesn't lodge a FIR, he is violating the Supreme Court mandate in Dalita Kumari versus state of UP. That is a mandate. It is mandatory that the FIR must be registered, isn't it? And it must be registered and action must be taken into picture here. That is why the role of a police officer is significant in criminal officer. So he brings the magistrate before the magistrate under Section 162. Then the role of the magistrate is to apply his judicial mind. Whether the police officer has exercised his mind or not, whether while effecting arrest, has he followed the safeguard? Has he given the grounds of arrest to the accused person? Has he informed his family members as to why is he arresting? Has he informed the accused person he has a right of representation to a lawyer of his choice, which is a fundamental right under Article 22 of the Constitution of India? If these are not, whether has he taken him to the doctor, his body is checked or not, whether any injury, ye sab dekhne ke baad, then the case diary ke andar, what is that police person, why he wants a custody beyond that? And he should not grant it unless reasons are recorded by the magistrate in a cogent manner, placing on record that here the offense is of a serious nature and the allegations are serious nature. Police should be given time. At the same time, he must balance the liberty provisions of Article 21 of the accused person. If he is a person not running away from the custody, if he is not going to tamper with witnesses, he should record, he should give bail. So the option is to give a magisterial custody or a police custody upon. So this is all material, very important material before the court of law, which is produced, which acts as evidence while forming a charge sheet under the provisions of Section 173, and which is ultimately charges are framed from 2 Section 11, 12, 13 foot onward. So that is called relevant facts before the court of law, a fact in issue. That is come under Section 2. You must lead evidence of fact in issue. So that those are the facts where A has committed the murder of B. The police officer has collected the pistol, the gun, the chopper, and examined the witnesses, shots, and he has collected autopsy report, doctor's report. So these are all facts in issue. That must be placed. That is what the provisions of Section 5, 6. Then I will deal each and every section here, how the fact forming the part of the same transaction, a tape record evidence is available. Then facts showing motive, preparation, conduct, what is there in his mind, circumstantial evidence. वो सब देखेंगे. देन अलाबाई कमिंग अंडर सेक्शन 11 दैट द अक्यूज वाज नॉट प्रेजेंट एट द टाइम व्हेन द ऑफेंस वाज कमिटेड ही कैन टेक द प्ली ऑफ अलाबाई दैट इज स्कैम. फैक्ट्स रिलेटिंग टू कस्टम्स, फैक्ट रिलेटिंग टू डाइंग डिक्लेरेशन, द फैक्ट रिलेटिंग टू कस्टडी, दीज आर ऑल कमिंग अंडर सेक्शन. फैक्ट रिलेटिंग टू कैरेक्टर एविडेंस, दे कम अंडर द प्रोविजन हियर, द सेकेंड पार्ट हियर. नाउ दैट इज द फर्स्ट पार्ट. The first part of that is chapter one of part one. Now, okay. Now the part two. Then now part two deals with the proof of the matter. I told you the part two deals with chapter number. Sir, yes, Pulo.
Sir, are we allowed to in tribunals and all? Are we allowed to dilute the provisions of the Indian Evidence Act, or you are not allowed to in case of tribunals? And what constitutes as an evidence?
In case of the tribunal, the strict principles of evidence are not applicable. They are more liberal. So the discretion is given to the presiding officer to allow the evidence, such as, for example, a Xerox copy, a newspaper report. A consumer court mein gaye aapne, there's a deficiency of service. You may, paper mein report aa gaya, samjana, so and so petrol pump is cheating. They are not doing it.
Yes, sir.
So company material is gone. So that newspaper report can be evidence before a tribunal. The tribunal can take cognizance of the Times of India report, Indian Express report, or some affidavit here. They need not go into detail, and like a civil court will not accept it. So the tribunal will follow its own procedure that is based on justice, equity, and good conscience.
Thank you, sir. And in that comic case, sir, for the UP thing where the High Court convicted and the Supreme Court said, "What is this? Why haven't you given bail?" So the reason they said was that the due process was not followed, and that is why it's bad in law.
Section 41 was not followed. Section 41 sub clause 2 speaks of a notice must be given. A police officer, while arresting an accused person, has to record reasoning under 41. If he doesn't record, that is the fundamental reasoning. When you read the judgment of Dalita Kumari's case, it is given to you. Even if you read the judgment of the subsequent judgment of the Supreme Court, what is the 216 judgment? What is the famous Hindi actress name who won the international award? What is the name? If I forget his name, it is on her name. It is Kumari versus State of UP. If you see that here, how the police officers must behave, they can record it here. So without giving reason, the Supreme Court took the view that here you are not given notice to them. There is a violation. The Supreme Court had repeatedly said here in Nakin Kumar's case here earlier, then there's a rampant misuse of Section 498 earlier. You know that here. And every wife who is unhappy with the husband, she'll go and lodge a complaint. And not only husband arrested, in-laws, somebody sick, people, relation, brother-in-law, people coming from abroad, London, they are arrested at the airport. So that was being misused under 498. The Supreme Court says that you cannot arrest like this in a rampant manner, and notice must be given. If you don't give a notice in matrimonial matters, you cannot arrest only now. And that you please see the Dalita Kumari judgment here. In matrimonial mass matter, as far as possible, the arrest should be avoided. Unless the officer is totally convinced, he must record reasoning, and he must obtain the permission of his senior. समझे ना आप वो सीनियर का परमिशन लेके अरेस्ट कर सकता है. ओके दैट इज इट.
सो हाउ डिड दे फाइंड आउट सर दैट द रीजनिंग वाज नॉट गिवन? आई मीन हाउ डिड द हाई कोर्ट मिस समथिंग सो बेसिक एज दिस एंड देन ओनली द सुप्रीम कोर्ट कॉट इट?
हाई कोर्ट हैज टर्न एन एल्सन साय. अनफॉर्चूनेटली द सुप्रीम कोर्ट हैज बीन वेरी शार्प, इजंट इट? सम जजेस ओवरलुक इट, सम जजेस डोंट, यू नो, इट्स हैपेंस. इट्स वेरी अनफॉर्चूनेट. It is sometime happened. It is a human mind. That is how, when mistakes are committed by the High Court, Supreme Court is there. Sometimes Supreme Court also overlooks, and the next bench sees it here. It is unfortunate. Sometime it happens. Sometimes the clients are lucky. Sometimes they are unlucky. As a lawyer, you must be very alert. The credit goes to the advocate to point out this fact. See, probably in the High Court, the lawyer may not have pointed out to the High Court. It is not, of course, the High Court judge ought to have seen it. I'm not saying no. At the same time, his lawyer must have impressed upon the court, my lord, this is a violation of Section 41. There is notice is not given. That finding is not recorded, isn't it? So it is not proper to entirely blame the High Court, and we are collectively responsible, even as lawyers. Okay?
Yes, it happened.
We all are human beings. We are. So fortunately, the Supreme Court has been very alert in that case, like in many cases, and it did it. Okay?
Sir, one quick question.
Yes.
Sir, that reasons, the like how good the reason is and the merits of the reason will be contested in trial. Na? They can't be contested during 482, this thing, right?
Oh, I'll tell you. That is it's a consideration of a bail period is called interlocutory orders. Okay?
Okay.
The interlocutory orders, you need not wait till the trial. That is only when you are convicting a person, recording how many years he must be sent to jail, then at the time of trial. For consideration of caution and consideration of prayer for granting a bail, and you need not wait the trial. But trial, then you will be languishing for 10, 15 years, isn't it? So this is an interlocutory stage, like an application for injunction. You cannot say that it should be heard along with the main suit after 10 years. You are moving the court for an order of injunction. There is an apprehension that the defendant is disposing of the property. They are alienating the property. You want immediate order. So similarly, your life and liberty is being violated. Your fundamental right under Article 20 are at stake. Isn't it? So why should you be languishing? Your reputation is going to be brought down in the country, and you will be humiliated in public. Why should you be humiliated? These are important, urgent, interlocutory. They are in consonance with the fundamental rights enshrined in Chapter 3 of the Indian Constitution, and they should be heard immediately. So when you see Section 41B of the CRPC, which has been added, every police officer must provide reasons, isn't it? The 41A chakra of CRPC ke andar, notice of appearance before a police officer, isn't it? This has been amended in the year 2010. Please try and keep a latest copy of the CPC CRPC Evidence Act. All BERACs you must have latest. Section 40 and 41A. So don't have the publication of the year 1980 and argue before the court. Latest, because CPC, CRPC evidence, they are all are being amended from time to time, every 6 months. So when you see Section 41A, this has been added by pursuant to the amending Act of 5 or 2009 in the year 2010. Very important. That notice, according to me, the High Court is right. Anybody has any question on this before I proceed?
Sir, I had another question. Can an appellate court take evidence?
Yes. Under 41 Rule 27A, padhi na apne CPC ke andar bhul gaye kya? I think you didn't attend my lecture. The appellate court is...
Sir, so the Indian evidence...
Pardon? क्या बोले एविडियन हेलो
सर फॉर द सेम सर सो द इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट वुड बी एप्लीकेबल इन इट्स स्ट्रिक्ट सेंस राइट
इंडियन बिकॉज एविडेंस इज एडमिस इज अ प्रोसीजरल लॉ द सीपीसी एंड सीआरपीसी विल कम इनटू प्ले बेटा
ओके सर
द एविडेंस एक्ट विल टेल यू एट व्हाट स्टेज यू मस्ट रिकॉर्ड इट एविडेंस एक्ट इज अ प्रोसीजरल लॉ प्लस एडजेक्टिव लॉ Evidence Act cannot be read in isolation. Evidence Act must be read in conjunction with the Code of Civil Procedure and the CRPC. Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
Because
yes, sir.
Appeal is a continuation of your original suit. Because appellate court can reappreciate the entire evidence, but not the revisional court and not the writ court. and not the Supreme Court. Under Article 136, their powers are limited. Under Article 226, powers are limited. Under 482, there are vast powers. But the appellate powers, exercising appellate power, either under Section 96 of the Code of Civil Procedure or under Section 102, 104, and read with this Section Order 43(1), they're all very wide powers. Similarly, under the scheme of the CRPC, the appeals, dealing Section 374, 378, the appellate court can examine. It is appellate court can go into the evidence. Okay? So evidence can come and record, but you have to explain to the court, why did you not bring this evidence at the earlier stage? Something happened. You have to give reason in the affidavit explanation. Normally, the appellate court is liberal in allowing parties to lead evidence if it is important. The party was though diligent, could not produce it. Subsequently, the evidence has come on record. You may take up the plea that year, my grandfather's will was there. I could not produce it, but after 10 years, there are more documents that come on record. So I may be permitted to lead evidence on that. Somebody dead in the family and you brought on record, a subsequent purchaser is come on record, he should be allowed to lead evidence. During appeal also, you can you just permit me, I will take one phone here. One minute.
Yes, sir.
I am visible now?
Yes, sir. So when would you request the appellant court to record evidence that we missed out earlier on, and when would you request it to send it back to the lower court so that evidence may be recorded?
Now the reasons are set out in the order 41, rule 27. Aap check karo CPC ka koliye. Order 4127, padhiye aap. Gitanshu, please open the order to order 41, rule 27. Ashish, you can also help him out.
Yes, sir.
Padhiye uske andar aapke do teen reason. They are short reasonings are there. Can you read it loudly?
Sir, I'm to.
Can anybody read Order 41, Rule 27? Can anybody open and put it up? Order 41, Rule 27. Himanshu,
So I'm having problems loading, just a second.
He will help you, just one up. This you require to learn, please, all of you. And Gitanshu, please learn it here. Anybody, any student can help? Any participant?
Yes, sir, Pandav.
Please put it up on the net for everybody's benefit.
डाल पा रहे हैं आपने नहीं?
ब्रेक्स लाइव लोड ही नहीं हो रहा है सर.
You have got anybody CPC with you? Order 47, Order 41, Rule 27.
Sir, it's shown on the screen.
आप बता दीजिए. आप पढ़िए मैडम तो कोई देख लो तरह. Order 40, Rule 27.
Can everyone read that?
Yes.
Yes.
Able to see the they said open here. Yes. See production of additional evidence in appellate court. Can anybody please read it?
Please.
The parties to an appeal shall not be entitled to produce additional evidence, whether oral or documentary, in the appellate court. But if the court from whose decree the appeal is preferred has refused to admit evidence which ought to have been admitted, or the party seeking to produce additional evidence establishes that notwithstanding the exercise of due diligence, such evidence was not within his knowledge or could not, after the exercise of due diligence, be produced by him at the time when the decree appeal against was passed, or the appellate court requires any document to be produced or any witness to be examined to enable it to pronounce judgment, or for any other substantial cause, the appellate court may allow such evidence or document to be produced or witness to be...
Yes, now you can stop it here. Now this is, these are the powers of a civil court, to allow additional evidence at the time of the appeal. Now please open section 391 CRPC. Section 391 CRPC.
Yes, sir.
Padhiye, please. Can you read section 391?
Yes.
Yeah, please go through, read it.
Appellate court may take further evidence or direct it to be taken. In dealing 391-1, in dealing with any appeal under this chapter, the appellate court, if it thinks additional evidence to be necessary, shall record its reasons and may either take such evidence itself or direct it to be taken by a magistrate, or when the appellate court is a high court, by a court of sessions or a magistrate.
Yes.
When the additional evidence is taken by the court of session or the magistrate, it or he shall certify such evidence to the appellate court, and such court shall thereupon proceed to dispose of the appeal. The accused or his pleader shall have the right to be present when the additional evidence is taken. The taking of evidence under this section shall be subject to provisions of chapter 23 as if it were an inquiry.
Yes. Now, it's from this section, order 41, rule 27 and section 391 CRPC. It is now crystal clear to you that the question of the student get answered. Now I will tell you why the reason, why the appellate court, can you all see me in the screen?
Sir.
Why the appellate court permits this evidence? Because appeal is the continuation of the original proceeding. Please note that. The appellate court has a right to correct the records, not only from the legal point of view, and also the factual point of view. Because a single judge or an inferior judge, a magistrate court, civil judge, junior, also the factual point of the court. Because a single judge or an inferior judge, a magistrate court, or a civil judge, senior division, junior division, small causes court, city civil court, may have committed mistake. Even a district court, the high court acting as an appellate court, or any other appellate court, may interfere. Why? Because the provisions of the Evidence Act, CPC and CRPC, these three acts are known as procedural laws and adjective laws. Now, there are Supreme Court judgments plenty when you see that a procedural law must be construed in a liberal manner for advancing the cause of justice and not to impede justice. Parties should be given fullest opportunity to lead evidence and prove their case or disprove their case. They cannot be ex parte hearing. They must not be injustice to anybody. Full opportunity must be given.
Sir, could you repeat the last part, the last sentence about being liberal, procedural law being liberal?
Yes. CPC, CRPC, Evidence Act. No? CPC, CRPC, essentially, they are known as procedural laws. The procedural law must be construed, must be interpreted in a liberal manner for advancing the cause of justice and not to impede justice. I-M-P-E-D. You cannot put obstacles. Ours is an Anglo-Saxon system of trial, where under everybody is given opportunity to lead evidence and prove their case. That is why from the trial court till the appellate court, the courts are liberal. So once after the, once the matter is traveled after the appellate court, it's not very easy to record evidence. You cannot tell the High Court and Supreme Court, I may be allowed to lead evidence as a matter of course. Yes, those courts, the High Court under Article 226, 227, has a plenary powers, extraordinary power. It is suo motu, the court may say, yes, in my opinion, this the evidence is deficient, not correctly recorded. And I am remanding the matter back to the trial court for recording evidence. And similarly, the Supreme Court powers under Article 142 of the Constitution of India. Yes, you know the Article 142. Plenary powers. The Supreme Court can pass any orders. Supreme Court is the only court which has got plenary powers under 142, can pass any kind of orders in order to make that judgment, whatever it deems fit. But you cannot dictate to the court. You cannot dictate to the High Court. So the court will, it has its own compulsion. It has its own discretion. But till the appellate court, you may insist before the court. As a matter of right, you can make the application. But I'm afraid the same thing will not do before the High Court and Supreme Court. But you may pursue. If you are a good pursuing lawyer and your judges are compassionate, they may allow it. Okay, otherwise, normally, it may not. Yeah. Okay, this is now clear to you, the appellate court. Now, the now we are dealing with part 2. In the part 2, dealing with the proof of the document, here it deals with chapter 3. Chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5. Now, I will deal with here. Chapter 5, chapter, part 2, may chapter 3, deals with the section 56 and 57. 56 speaks of a judicially noticeable fact. I mean, the facts which the court will take judicial notice. The court will say the judgment of the Supreme Court of India is produced. It need not be proved. Because Supreme Court judgment, the court will take judicial notice, it is correctly produced. A seal of the map of India, Ashoka Chakra, it is produced before the court of law. Court will take a judicial notice, it is correct. There is no need to examine the parliamentarian. There is no need to examine the judge who delivered the judgment. So the court will take judicial notice. 57 and 58 of the Evidence Act tells you, facts which are admitted by the parties need not be proved. There are certain admissions which are made. Because you learned under the CPC, Code of Civil Procedure, ordered 10 and 12 ke andar padhe aapne, 12 ke andar admissions, how they are recorded. Similarly, the under the Evidence Act, there is chapter section 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, they deal with admission. If a fact is admitted, that need not be proved. So that deals with it here. From waha se lekar, 28 se lekar, till 58 onwards. Okay? That is chapter number 3. Now, chapter 4 deals with the oral evidence. Kindly note that here. I'm coming. The chapter, this is a very important aspect here. Oral evidence. I mean, parties are directed. The evidence is of various type, I told you here. So, one of the type is oral evidence, where a party who has seen the incident that goes to the before the court of law and deposes, yes, I have seen A committing the murder of B. He is an eyewitness. that the oral witness must be direct, the person who has seen, perceived, and he must come before the court and give evidence. That is called the direct evidence or oral evidence. Then oral evidence ke andar do part hote hain. There's also hearsay evidence. I mean, I heard A told me that B has killed C and C was responsible for the problem. So here it is not the question that he himself personally seen. He heard from somebody else. That evidence is a weak evidence. It is normally not admissible unless in certain cases, which I'll explain to you under Section 32 of the Evidence Act. बाद में देख लेंगे. Then Section 60 deals with the oral evidence must be direct here, 59 and 60. Then chapter 5 पे आ जाइए आप, that deals with documentary evidence. Section 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 65A, they're all documentary evidence. Documentary evidence is again two type. One is called primary evidence, mean the original document. When you are relying upon, when you seek a declaration that year, I am entitled to the ownership of this plot of land, I have purchased it from Mr. X, you must produce the agreement, original agreement of sale, or you must produce the conveyance deed, the original copy. That is called, when you are going for a probate of the document will, the will original must be produced before the protonotary in the court of law for the document. You cannot say that yet. So the original must come on record. That is called primary evidence. It is one of the best evidence. So the best evidence is, earlier I told you, a direct evidence, a person who has seen it here. So the second best evidence is the primary evidence. Sometime the original copy is lost, not in your possession. It may be in the custody of the builder. The defendant must be with the collector's office. Ab kya karenge? You only have a Xerox copy. The Xerox copy or a certified copy which has been obtained from the government and the RTI, they are all known as secondary evidences. You are permitted to, in the absence of a primary evidence, parties are allowed to produce secondary evidence, provided certain guidelines are followed. Number one, under Section 66 of the Evidence Act, the party who seeks to produce the secondary evidence must send a letter to the other party that I have in my possession only the Xerox copy, whereas the original is lying with you at the time when we booked the flat, which was mortgaged with you, which you have not handed over to me. The matter is kept for trial before the court of law and for recording evidence. I will be tendering the copy, Xerox copy with me. You are requested to bring the original document in the court on the next date when evidence is being recorded, so that that document can be taken and recorded by the Honorable Court and marked as exhibit and read in evidence. This is what, as a trial lawyer, you will do this. Please read Section 66, we'll come to know that. ये देने के बाद अदर साइड डज नॉट प्रोड्यूस इट फॉर ए रीजन बी रीजन सी रीजन ओके देन यू मे इन्फॉर्म द कोर्ट माय लॉर्ड आई हैव डिस्चार्ज माय बर्डन नेमली आई गेव अ लीगल नोटिस अंडर 66 टू आस्किंग हिम टू प्रोड्यूस द डॉक्यूमेंट व्हिच ही हैज फेल्ड टू डू इन माय ओपिनियन द ज़ेरॉक्स कॉपी इज द सेम डॉक्यूमेंट टेकन बाय मी अर्लियर इट वॉज दिस कॉपी वॉज गिवन टू मी बाय द डिफेंडेंट हिमसेल्फ I produce, the contents are correct. This copy was taken from the original. There is no variance. The court will take it. Then another example, how the, when the original is lost, not traceable, suppose a will document or a, or maybe a certified copy or a original sale deed is misplaced. Then what you do? I have a Xerox copy which is given to my charter accountant. I had a Xerox copy which I had kept with my brother. I had a copy which is given to electric authorities. You may tell the court, there was a robbery in my house. The original has been lost and it has been misplaced. What you will do as a lawyer? Advise your client to go and lodge a FIR.
in respect of the document which has been misplaced or which has been lost. Either telling the police officer that the document has been lost in the robbery or for reason XYZ. I have only a copy which is there. So court ko inform karenge aap? I gave a notice to the police. I informed the police I lost the information. The original is misplaced. I am unable to trace. I have exercised best diligent efforts. Well, I am not in a position to produce it. So the Xerox copy which is in my possession is a good document. This honorable court be pleased to permit me to adduce a secondary evidence. Ma'am, allow me to produce Xerox copy. Then section 63K requirement comply karo. That document will be accepted by the court, subject to no serious objection by the other side. If the court is of the opinion the document is relevant to the subject matter and issue, and it is it has a bearing on the fact and issue, okay, otherwise it won't be accepted. That is the secondary evidence. Then you have electronic evidence 65B, which has been introduced in the Right to Information Act here. You know that here? So that you know the digital signatures can be proved here. That is very easy. Then certain cases where the court may presume document are correct or not correct, that still section 90 tak aap dekh liye, presumption, that chapter. Then chapter 6 is important, which deals with exclusion. Exclusion of oral evidence by documentary evidence. Isko bhi kehte hain, how a party is permitted to lead extrinsic evidence. Oral evidence. Normally, when you have a registered sale deed, the parties are governed by the sale deed. Agent and principal having a dispute under the Indian Contract Act with regard to commission. Or landlord and tenant are having a dispute with regard to fixation of a rent or terms and conditions of a tenancy. Mortgager and mortgagee are having problem with regard to interpretation of the deed of English mortgage or usufructuary mortgage. So when there are disputes about the document, how the disputed facts, you may take up the plea that year. The defendant will say that the plaintiff made me sign this document without explaining the nature of the document. I am an illiterate man. I do not know English. I was in need of money. I signed the document. But fraudulently, he has introduced certain clauses which are detrimental to my interest. He told me that he will charge me only a 6% interest. Now, the agreement, when I got it read from a lawyer, he told me I had to pay 25%. The agreement is sham, colorable, bogus. It doesn't reflect the true intention. As a mortgage, he told me after 10 years, it can be redeemed. After reading the document, he said that the mortgage document can never be redeemed. So there's a clog on the mortgage. Isn't it? The surrounding circumstances, the intention of the parties are not reflected in the document. The document is sham, colorable, bogus. The document should be set aside. So, I must be allowed to lead oral evidence to prove that the plaintiff or defendant has played a fraud upon me and upon this honorable court. So, the particulars of fraud will not be mentioned in the document. So in the city of Bombay, you know that here, the many agreements are written down by the parties, landlord and tenant, licensee and licensor, varying the term. They do not want to pay with a view to, you cannot charge rent which is more than the standard rent earlier. There is an arrangement for cash amount transaction to defeat the provision. Do you enter into a contract, maybe agreement of leave and license in respect of a commercial transaction, placing on record, is actually a lease. So the defendant will take up the plea. The agreement is a sham. The relationship is not leave a license, it is actually a lease created. The intentions were different. It is for 15, 20 years. It's a long lease. I was not to be dispossessed. So you can be allowed to lead oral evidence. When price is not fixed by the parties, a time is the essence of a contract. A delivery is not mentioned in the contract. So the other party can say that here, I should be allowed to lead oral evidence in that regard too. So this is what section 91 and 92 of the Evidence Act will tell you in chapter 6 relating to. Okay, then part 3, the final part, that the final part of the Evidence Act deals with production and effect of evidence. So the court permitted you document when examination chief aapne file kiye, your plain and written statement is not evidence. Now under of the provisions of order 14, order 7, rule 14, it says that the documents must be exhibited. Then order 8, rule 1 ACPC tells you the defendant must produce all the documents. Then the list of documents are given to you under order 19. So you bring before the court of law, these are the documents which are relevant. So that said documents may be taken on record and read in evidence. So merely because the court has taken on record the document and exhibited, the same is not evidence. Now you have to prove the proof of the document. You have to say before the court of law, the defendant can take up the plea that the agreement is not registered. Though it may be consideration, like an unregistered document is not receivable in evidence. Isn't it? So,
If the will is not probated, it is not evidence, no, sir?
Yeah, if the will is not probated, you cannot give effect to the intention. You cannot give it. You have to, if it is, except the Christians and the Muslims are exempted from the operation of section 213 of the Indian Succession Act, they need not. But the Hindus, the Parsis and the others are required to prove it. Otherwise, the will is invalid. You must lodge a probate. That is the validity. After the death of the testator, you must apply to the district court in the city of Bombay, the High Court original site. So the documents must be proved. What kind of a proof must be given? That is called burden of proof. Section 101 se lekar, dekhi aap, 114A. No, you have a burden of proof. Who should discharge the burden? In a criminal cases, normally the prosecution must prove the case beyond reasonable doubt. In the civil cases, the plaintiff who has filed the suit for declaration or division of property must lead evidence. But sometimes the burden may shift. In the civil cases, if the defendant takes up the plea that the court has no jurisdiction, that issue will be tried by the court as a preliminary issue under Order 14, Rule 2, and ask the defendant to step in and lead evidence. So burden is shifted. Isn't it? Similarly, under the Indian Penal Code, A has committed the murder of B. The prosecution, the state, is enjoined with a duty to prove the charge beyond reasonable doubt. The public prosecutor has to begin the case and prove the case. But if the defendant, the accused, takes up the plea that he was suffering from insanity, he was not able to understand the nature of the offense. Section 84 of the IPC tells you the burden, he is permitted to take up the defense. Then he must discharge that burden first. So that who should discharge the burden and proof is shifting. It dealt under section 101 se lekar aap dekhiye pura 124. There are various proofs of territory, presumption of proof, and when the court may presume a document, whether a letter dispatched from the post office has reached or not, whether the document which has a telex message has not correctly sent or not, are all given. The proof must be established. If you are not in a position to tell before the court that the agreement of sale or a will you must inform the court, this is the signature of the defendant, of your grandfather, plaintiff, in a suit for specific performance. You must tell the court, this is suit for specific performance. I am asking for that he must perform the part of a contract, put me into possession, convey the property. First, the existence of the agreement, a registered agreement. Yes, these are my signature. This is the defendant's signature. I paid the consideration. The contents are correct. The document, then as a lawyer, you will tell the court, yes, my lord, I produce my to substantiate my case for declaration and for the relief sought. I am producing herewith the registered sale deed. The sale deed is executed between me and the plaintiff and defendant. I have paid the consideration on so and so date. The last page bears his signature, my signature. This is a registered document, unregistered document, whatever may be. The contents are correct. So as a lawyer, you get up and before the court, my lord, the document stands proved under the provisions of the Indian Evidence Act. Your lordship may kindly exhibit the document. So before the exhibition, I will tell you the procedure tomorrow. The court asks the parties to give their objection, no objection, with regard to admissibility, non-admissibility of document. Wo topic main iske baad lunga, kal bhi lunga, iske andar. Uske baad ho gaya. Then next, chapter 8. See, chapter 8, in this comes estoppel. No? Estoppel is dealt under section 115, 116 and 117 of the Evidence Act. So normally, estoppel means a promise made by A to B that I will give you this much. I will transfer this property after 5 years. A representation which has been given, which has not been honored, with the defendant plaintiff knew that it was true. The defendant knows that he doesn't want to do it. So there's a doctrine of estoppel, promissory estoppel. Government of India tells the issues advertisement in newspaper, set up small scale industries in a remote scale area, village areas, for augmenting productivity. Those who set up these small scale industries, we will give them taxation rebate for 20 years. So, relying upon the representation, several people set up factories to promote industry. Industry khoob chalne lagi, paisa kamane lage aapko. Government of India retracted the promise and send you taxes pay karo. You can challenge it. On the ground that there is the demand of the Government of India demanding amount of taxes is illegal. In fact, a representation was given to us at the time of the setting up of the factory, they will not charge us. They are estopped by the doctrine of promissory estoppel as contained under 115. A tenant cannot challenge the title of the landlord having paid the rent. There is an estoppel. If A has promised to sell B the land on the ground that he is going to be the beneficiary of the property from his grandfather in future, so I sell it to you at this stage if you buy 10% less. That's lucky property, you give me 8 lakhs. So the poor plaintiff gives him 8 lakhs. Huh? The property is still in the name of grandfather. Unless the grandfather dies, he cannot become the owner. So the grandfather died. Immediately upon the death, the plaintiff gives a notice to the defendant. Please transfer the property now. Your grandfather died, it must have come to you. He said, no, my name is probating Ilya Abhithar. It cannot be transferred. Then subsequently, he applies for a probate and transfer. He can't take up the plea that now at the time of the contract, I was not the owner. I became later on. So a promissory estoppel come into play here. These are all in civil cases which come. Then chapter 9, which we deal with, deals with witnesses. When you have produced, who are the witnesses in civil cases and criminal cases? Section 118 se lekar This chapter is interesting. Will tell you any person can be a witness till 134th. Okay, number of witness, how many witnesses, quality and quantity that deals. Who can be, whether a judge can be a witness or not, a magistrate can be judge or not, whether the wife can be a witness against the husband, whether a lawyer can be a witness against the law husband. They're all issues dealt under the provisions of this chapter that is dealing with the witnesses. In chapter 9, we'll discuss a very interesting topic, and we'll consume some time when we swing into action from tomorrow onward, in the next lecture onward. After witnesses ke baad, then chapter 10, then examination of the witnesses. First you learn who are the witnesses, who can be, what is the age, how many numbers, then examination process involves examination chief, cross examination and re examination, the order of examination. Section 35 se lekar that is section 166, that very interesting topic here, which I will deal with you. We will go sequence of order, not exactly like the sections I mentioned, but I will proceed with the Evidence Act in the manner we follow in the court of law, how the evidence is recorded by judges, civil court as well as criminal court. I will discuss with you from the next lecture onwards. That is a examination chapter is a chapter 9, examination of witness, that is order, examination chief, cross examination, re examination, wo sab dekh lenge hum log. Then the last chapter is chapter 11, that is improper admissions and rejection of evidence. That is the last section, that is called no new trial for improper admission rejection, because the judges have a very vast power to ask any question under section 165. Under 162, production of documents are allowed. A person who produces the document cannot be cross-examined unless he comes to the court of law as a witness. Please note that here. A judge has, you as a counsel cannot ask any question you want. Only you can ask relevant question to the issue. Whereas a judge under section 165 can put up any question, may be relevant or irrelevant, but he will give his judgment based on answers which are relevant. That is 165. 167, may there is no de novo trial, there is no new trial just because the learned judge or appellate court rejected your application for new evidence. You cannot say that your appellate court, I am demanding the matter should be remanded back under the provisions of order 41, rule 24, I may be allowed to lead evidence. No, it is not. If you are led wrong evidence for A reason, B reason, you cannot try to rectify at the appellate stage. I may be allowed to correct a new stage. Hold for me a new trial. So when a new trial takes place, under what circumstances, that is called de novo trials, that I will take it up. So in all, there are total 167 sections. Each section is tempting and interesting of the Evidence Act. Evidence Act is both applicable to civil cases and criminal cases, barring certain sections such as confession, which are strictly applicable to the criminal cases, and preponderance of possibilities and estoppel, which are applicable to civil cases, barring these two, three certain events. And the entire Evidence Act is applicable to the CPC, CRPC, and it is a law, an adjective law, which tells the parties and the advocate, how do you set into motion, how do you attain your substantive right title interest, how do you convict a man who has committed the offense. You have to follow the strict procedure. Then next lecture, anybody asks, this is a general lecture today, from tomorrow onwards I will take you the application of the act. The act applies to the entire India except the state of Canada. Of course, with the amalgamation of the Kashmir, there should be no problem in also applying this act, but still they have their own law in force. Then to arbitrators, it does not apply. It will apply tomorrow. Anybody want to ask me question today?
Sir, thank you so much for summarizing the
Wednesday. but timings will have to modify, and not 4 o'clock. Is 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock is okay with you all? Please tell me. We can take 1.5 hour lecture. 6 o'clock is better for me because I can wind up my court matters and come. I can sacrifice my meetings for you all, no problem. But I cannot sacrifice the court matters.
Yes, sir.
Please be available and we'll meet up several times. 6 o'clock, 7:30, 1.5 hour would be more appropriate every day, according to me. And anybody has any question, Wednesday, please, Jitanshu, Jiteshu, and please keep the next lecture on Wednesday at about 6 p.m. 6 p.m. to 7:30, we can keep it. Okay, and I do not mind taking further time also, subject to your patience and perseverance.
Sir, there are some lectures also lined up at 7 p.m.
Ji, kya bole?
Some other lectures are also lined up at 7 p.m. I suppose.
7 p.m. hai. Evening mein hai aapke shop mein?
Yes, sir. 7 o'clock in the evening.
Okay, we'll wind up then. Aise kare. Will 4:30.
Sorry, sir. Which subject is this at 7 that we have?
Kiska hai?
We are banking.
Oh, banking.
Which professor taking?
Sir, banking is not fixed till. Although she had said it is 7 o'clock, but we are not having the lecture.
Professor, so we can I can let. Permit me to come. I'll finish at 6:30. Okay.
Can we request the banking professor to move it by half an hour so sir can take from 6 to 6?
Correct.
He's been taking the lecture so far, so we don't have any issues, and sir can continue for how much of a time, that's not an issue.
I will start from 6 o'clock from Wednesday onward. I will take lectures Monday, Wednesday, sir. Monday, Wednesday, sometime Thursday. Sometimes Saturday I may skip because I had to go out of Mumbai to look after my animals and my farms. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So give me the my indulgence. So we will meet now Wednesday at 6 p.m. Okay? Sir, anybody has any question, please ask.
Yes, sir. What do we have to read for the Wednesday's lecture, sir? What is the homework for Wednesday's lecture?
I will be starting with section 1, application, how the act applies. And definition, the quotes, padhenge hum log.
Sir, any case law you have to read?
Case law I will be covering, don't worry. I will be covering, don't read it. Because the way I have been covering to you in CPC, CRPC, I'll cover it here. Because all the case laws are latest coming up in live law, you can go through it.
So CPC, CRPC used to give us case laws to do at home and then you would ask us the questions. Anything you want us to read?
Mai dunga. Yeah, I have it. You can discuss one case law which I propose to give you. I'm giving you, I'll write now, I'll give you. On the interpretation, the Supreme Court, what does the Supreme Court says? 1 minute, 19, Bhavani Nazish. Yeah, 1961 padke aayi aap. Got it?
No, sir.
Yeah, 1961 Supreme Court. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir. So the parties and this?
Party ka naam de raha hai abhi aapko. It's a leading judgment. State of Punjab versus. Wait. Giving you. Subha Rao judgment. State of Punjab versus. Sodi Sukhdev Singh. Yeah, 1961 Supreme Court, page number 493. Okay? This is
okay,
interpretation of the evidence provision, whether we can borrow the English principle, how the Evidence Act will be construed, whether the documents in the custody of a minister can be produced or not. Can they enjoy immunity or not?
Yes, sir.
How, when there is an ambiguity in the act, whether what kind of law to be followed, the English law, whether applicable or not. There's a beautiful discussion by Justice Gajendra Gadkar, Justice Subba Rao, very enlightening opinion on Evidence Act. These are the earlier judgments. These are landmark judgments. So landmark judgment, read and come.
Sir, what is the relevant page number?
Page number is
493.
493.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Data Punjab versus SS Singh. SS Singh means Sodhi Sukhdev Singh.
Sodhi Sukhdev. Okay. Thank you.
Oh, shall we wind up today?
Recording? Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. My pleasure. And those who could not attend the lecture, they can see it on the YouTube. I have requested our student to upload it in the YouTube. Gitanshu, recording kiya na aapne?
Yes, it's getting recorded, sir.
Okay. Get it uploaded.
Sir, excellent lecture, sir. Excellent lecture.
Excellent lecture. Really.
Yeah, I'll enjoy. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Because I will be teaching you from the point of view of the not only examination, but also from the practice point of view.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Will it be a new meeting for Wednesday or the same link?
Pardon?